Now in section 1.3.5, we will discuss the fundamental theorem for curls. This is also called as the Stokes theorem. This actually now relates this theorem. Let me first write this one, that if we are having a surface integral and we are having the curl of a vector quantity or a physical quantity, and this is the surface, the dot product with the surface, then this is equal if we take the closed path integral, means this is the line integral, and V dot dl. Now what this theorem is saying actually, this theorem is relating the surface integral to the line integral first. That if we are having a physical quantity and we find the flux of the curl of that quantity on a surface, definitely it's a flux, so it will be on a surface. This will be the same if we just take that quantity and line integrate it along the length element. So the result will be the same. It means that if we are having some area, and let's say that this is an area in which we are having different curls, then this is equivalent, means if I take the same area again, so if we are having the curling of a physical quantity here in this area, then how much is the flux of this curl? How much is the flux of this curl on this area? This is equivalent if we take that quantity on the surface and just calculate the along the length element, like the all we go just around the boundary of this thing, and the result will be the same. This is the left side of the equation, like we are calculating the flux of the curl of that physical quantity, and this is the right side of the equation, we just go around its boundary, means on a path integral, then the result will be the same. This is just like, let's say we are having, for example, let's say we are having a CD disk, and that CD disk is some ends are there on the CD disk, and individually all the ends are trying to rotate it, curling it. So how much this will curl is a result if we look at the corner of this CD disk and we find the curling of this one, just go around this one. So the flux of all the curls will be that we just look at the boundary of it. Or another example, let's say we are having an incompressible fluid like water, and we consider the whirlpool of the water. Now it is whirling, it is going around, it is curling. So how much, if I take a cross-sectional area in front of it, how much it is, how much is the flux of that curling? It will be given by if I look at the boundary of that whirlpool. So if I do calculate the line integral on the boundary of that whirlpool, it will give me the flux of that curling on the surface. So this is the theorem, and there are means this one is just giving us an ease that here we will have to do calculation on the surface, and here we can do the calculations on a line. So this is the benefit of this fundamental theorem for curls. There are two corollaries associated with this one. The first corollary is that del cross V dot dA. This is means it is not necessarily a closed surface. This del cross V dot dA depends only on the boundary line, not on a particular surface used. So it means it is not a closed surface. So it is not depending on a particular surface which we use here. And it will be the same thing like, let me give you an example. What does this mean? That it is not surface dependent. Let's say we are having a plot like this. Now consider, this is now a line plot, that this is a path integral. Now let's consider, we are having this image just on the ground, and let's say we are having a curved surface, and on the curved surface something is going in like this. Means just the shadow of this one is following this path which is here. So it's going on this one. Now the curvature of it, if we change this curvature, means change the surface here, this will not be affected. And that is one, you may find some animations of such a thing on the internet, that what does it mean? We are having, let's say this is a line which starts from here and just go along a curved surface. And then if you change the curvature of this one, then this shadow will not change. Means its shadow will just be a line integral. So it is not shape dependent. And another thing is that if I take this is a closed path, if this is a closed surface, then for any closed surface, means if I write here like this one, that it's now on a closed surface, S, and del cross V dot dA. Now it's a closed surface integral. And when it's a closed surface, then it will be equal to zero. Like we are having a balloon, and now the balloon, the mouth of the balloon is open, so we will have this knot is a closed surface. But if I make it a closed surface, mean you close the mouth of the balloon, then it shrinks to a point, and that's why the closed surface integral will come out to be zero. We are shrinking the cross-sectional area there, and we are shrinking it to a point, and then its dot product with that point will be equal to zero. So it says that for any closed surface, since the boundary line like the mouth of a balloon shrinks down to a point, and hence the right side of the equation then vanishes. So we are shrinking this one. Now look over here, that we are calculating the line integral here, and this is a closed path, then it will shrink, and it will shrink to zero. And similarly over here as well, if we are considering a closed path, then on a closed path the curl, the flux of the curl will be equal to zero. So this is the fundamental theorem for curls. And we write this one, let's say our physical quantity here is now an electric field. So a closed surface integral and del cross E dot dA is equal to a closed path integral in E dot dl. This is Ampere's law, and we will later on calculate this one. But look here, how much the electric field is curling. This del cross E will give that one. And then we find that curl through a cross-sectional area means the flux of the curl of electric field will be equal if we just integrate the electric field along the boundary, along the path of it, and the result will be the same. And in order to further understand this one, let me solve example 1.11. So in example 1.11, let me recite this example. It says, suppose a vector quantity is equal to 2xz plus 3y square in y plus 4yz square in z, means it is in the yz plane. Check Stokes' theorem for the square surface shown in figure 1.33. Now we will consider our geometry, and geometry is such that we are having our x, y, and z coordinate system. So here we are having, this is x, this is y, and this is z axis. And now our square is such that we are running along the y axis unit 1, and along the z axis also unit 1 here. So it will make a square. So we are running along this unit 1, and similarly it will be here. So it is somehow like this, and this is 0.11 now, and we are running then along z, then from y to z, and then from z to the origin back. So we are having, this is path 1 here, this is path 2 and 3 and 4 here. And we are having a vector, and the vector is equal, to 2xz plus 3y square, 2xz plus 3y square in y plus 4yz square and z unit vector. And we will calculate del cross v first, and then we will calculate the rest of the terms. So del cross v here is equal, we know that how to calculate the cross product x, y, and z here, and then it is curl, so curly by curly x, and curly by curly y, and curly by curly z here. So here we don't have any x component, and we are having the y component is 2xz plus 3y squared, and the z component is 4yz squared, and this we will now expand here. So del cross v comes out to be the very first one, it is curly by curly y of this one. So let me find this directly. So y will come out to be 1, so this is 4z squared, then minus curly by curly z of this, and it is minus 2x, and it is in the x direction, then minus the y component. So I will cancel this and this. Curly by curly x of this one is 0 here, minus then curly by curly z of 0, so it is also 0, and the y component we are having 0 here, plus the z component, and it will be curly by curly x of this, so it is 2z here, 2z here,